My name's Larry Fitzgerald. I'm the CEO of a pretty small company called Romf Composite Solutions. And I think I have one of the best jobs in the world because what we get to do every day is make the world lighter and safer. So why is lighter so important? Well, every vehicle that transports people around the planet, whether it's a plane, an automobile, has a lot of materials in it that have a lot of mass. And if they have a lot of mass, they burn a lot of fuel or use a lot of energy. So one of the best things we can do as a species to affect climate change is to make things lighter. So that's what we do every day. We take carbon fiber, Kevlar, fiberglass components, and we convert things that are made out of metal or steel or aluminum into something lighter. And every kilogram we save, for example, in the aerospace industry, saves about 8,000 kilograms of carbon emissions per year. So if you think about every plane in the world and how many trips they take, every kilogram matters. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about, briefly, my history. So I started in the industry coming out of the University of in electrical engineering, and I was designing microchips. I was about as geeky as you can get, like writing code, designing microchips. My sons like to remind me of that regularly, that I'm an uber geek. But over the course of my career, I kind of was gravitated towards leadership roles. I was very lucky to have a lot of mentors along the way. People that taught me a lot of things when I worked at a company called Celestica, and then later at Honeywell, and now today at Romf. So I first want to recognize that anything I share with you today, you know, I'm standing on the shoulders of giants that passed on that information, that knowledge. So I'm not here to give advice because I don't really feel like I'm qualified. What I'm here to do today is to share experience, a little bit about how to think like a leader, how to think like a CEO. And a lot of my life experience and things that I was taught by those mentors circles around one concept called lean thinking. Now, lean thinking is something that's been around for a long time. But basically what it means is, how do I get value? How do I create value with the least amount of resources possible? There are a lot of companies that exist on the planet today, in this world of ours, that create a lot of value, but they use a lot of resources to do that. So I personally think that lean thinking and a forward-thinking look at how do we reduce emissions and make, you know, reduce climate change impacts have a lot in common. So what I'm trying to do with this talk today is talk to you a little bit about how do you create value and how do you do that with the least amount of resources possible. So that starts with defining what is value. Well, in lean thinking, value is something that a customer is willing to pay for. Okay? So if you've got an iPhone in your pocket today, I'm sure you paid a lot of money for that. That's something that you valued and appreciate and would pay for. Well, there's a lot of steps in the process to make that. And what lean thinking does is say, how do I use the least amount of resources possible to create that valuable thing or information or whatever it is that you're actually producing in the most efficient way possible? Lean thinking's actually been around for a long time. A lot of people that study it think, well, it was invented by Toyota in the 1950s. It actually goes back about 500 years earlier than that. So lean thinking actually, a lot of people think, originated in Venice in the 15th century. In the 1450s, the Venetians were able to produce wooden ships, very complex trading and vessels that would travel all over Europe, all over the different parts of that landscape. And they were able to produce these ships in an hour, 1 hour, 500 years ago. They ended up producing the largest seafaring fleet of ships ever seen. And it was so powerful as a tool of trade and commerce that kings of England and France would travel across the continent to watch their production line. They literally floated these ships down a canal and built them in sequence. 500 years later, through a lot of different other efforts along the way, Henry Ford popularized the whole production line concept. And that basically was the same thing. How do I move things along and add value in the most efficient way possible? At the time, the joke was, you know, he modernized the industrial world and everybody started buying automobiles for the first time. And you could get a Model A or a Model T, and you could get any color you wanted, as long as you liked black. Because that's all that was available. because he had standardized things. Toyota comes along in the 1950s and says, well, not everybody likes black. So we're gonna get some different models, some different colors. And they took the concept a step further, how to still standardize and how to produce a variety of things that people will like, but same kind of core thinking, how to do it with the least amount of resources possible. So that's a little bit about lean. There's a very key concept that's part of what we call the lean production system that's been popularized around the world by companies like Toyota, Honeywell, where I learned it, Danaher, another company that's done very well producing this kind of, or using this kind of a system. And that's the concept of, there's two pillars to lean thinking. And the first one is respect. And you might think, what's respect got to do with a production system or creating value? Well, respect is one of the pillars of lean thinking and something that I think every CEO or aspiring leader should know, because you can't possibly know everything, right? You need to respect your coworkers. You need to respect the people that work for you. You, and importantly, must respect your rivals or competitors, because you're going to learn things from them. You're going to learn a lot. You're going to be able to apply that into your own thinking. It's one of the core pillars of lean, because if you have a culture of respect where everybody's opinion is valued, where every opinion can be brought to the table and you debate the best ideas, you will come up with the best possible solution and possibly create value for your end customers. So that's one of the first pillars of lean. The other thing you need to understand when it comes to lean thinking or how to think like a CEO is understanding the concept of waste. Waste is everywhere. The common production processes for any products or services out there typically will have 70 to 80% waste in the process. There are steps along the way that actually aren't adding value, but have been deemed to be necessary by somebody, right? So world-class production processes or information flow processes reduced that waste down to 30%, because there's always gonna be things you have to do. I joke with my wife, she's a business person and an accountant. I say accounting in general is waste, because it's not adding value, it's not transforming the product, it's not something that that actually adds value in the strictest of definitions, but it's still required, right? So you always wanna try to reduce the amount of waste possible where you can in these processes. So the Japanese actually call this term muda, or which literally translates from waste. So there's muda everywhere. In a production process or in an information process, one of the most common mudas is waiting. Have you ever queued up for getting into a movie theater or going to a restaurant in a process that we all live every day? That is one of my least favorite wastes, because there's nothing efficient about that, right? We're tying up resources, we're tying up people, and we're waiting. One of the other most common wastes when you look at processes is overproduction. If the customer wants 500 a year, there is no point in building 1,000 a year. So you have to understand what your customer wants and reduce the amount of overproduction that you do. There's a whole bunch of other wastes. If you want to learn more about this, I'd refer you to lean.org, and there's lots of information available on that that talks you about the 7, or depending on people think, 8 wastes. But there's one other waste I want to talk about, which is the most important, I think, and it ties into that culture of respect, which is unused creativity. So this was actually recently added in a lot of the lean lexicon and learning out there, because people were realizing, okay, we could be really, really efficient, but if we're not tapping into the creativity of all of our employees, everybody in the organization, then we're missing out on something, because everybody has something to add. So if you kind of get into that, keep these concepts in mind of respect for the entire organization, respect and using all of these ideas together, you can see how it fits together. I'm gonna share a story that I witnessed personally when I was actually studying lean in Japan. I was working on a production line in Panasonic, building air conditioners, and that was my job. Work on the production line for the day, observe and find out where there was efficiencies, where you could do things better. And while I was doing that, the president of the company was also doing it, standing nearby. And I watched, after he was there for about 2 hours, he just sat and watched for 2 hours. And then he went and talked to the team lead in the area. They were having a conversation in Japanese that I didn't quite follow along at all. But they were talking back and forth. And I could tell it was a very intense discussion. And then the president bowed. The other person bowed back, the team leader, and he walked away. And I was like, I don't know what that was all about. And the facilitators of this event basically told me the president had some ideas on how to improve production. And he was respectfully taking it to the team leader to present his ideas because the team leader was the one responsible for that area. They debated the ideas and the team leader eventually said, no, we're not going to do that. Can you imagine that happening in a North American company? President says, do this. You go, yes, sir. How soon, sir? Well, I'll do it right away. But in a Japanese system where they have so much respect for each other, he was empowered to say no. So that was a transformative moment in my career. I really understood, okay, I sort of get this respect thing. So that was one of the pillars of Lean. But what's the second pillar? Well, the second pillar is what we were there to do, which is continuous improvement. We're always seeking to get better. The end goal, if you're going to be a leader of an organization someday, and I hope there's some aspiring CEOs in the audience, you always want to get better. The goal is never attained. If you get to the goal, set a new goal. Because if you're not continuing to innovate, if you're not continuing to push the needle forward, then somebody else will, and you'll fall behind. So if you take those two core concepts of respect and continuous improvement, you can be, you create a pretty powerful management and operating system. So, okay, so that's great. We're gonna try all these continuous improvement ideas and we're always gonna innovate, that's great. But how do I find those ideas? How do I get those ideas? Well, that ties back to the concept of waste. Look for the things that are wasteful in the organization that you're in, the steps of the process that aren't necessary, and Kaizen them. Now that's just a simple word. Kaizen is another Japanese word that means change for the good. Kaizen, change for the good. So how do I change something to use less resources, have less waste, but still get the output I want? And if you do a lot of these Kaizens and you get the whole organization involved, it can be a very, very powerful system of change. Not unlike what you see in organization. There was a reference earlier to Taylor Swift. Taylor Swift is a great example of empowering an entire organization to think and change things. She's doing it from a different perspective. I think there's a lot of other good examples. The other one I would use is Elon Musk. He's constantly evolving in all of his businesses to change things. But one of the things he does really well is tap into that entire organization, right? So he's tapping into the organization to drive change. And one of the key things you need to remember if you do a lot of Kaizen or change for the good is you will fail. And that brings me to my next curious lean concept, which is that's okay, but just fail forward. Don't fail backward. What do I mean by fail forward? Fail forward means learn something from it. If you've tried something and it doesn't work, don't give up. Change your tactics. Try something else. Try it again. Try it again. Try it again. You might take 10, 12 tries before you get something right, but fail forward. When I look at the Canadian business culture, I see a lot of conservatism, failure to really try things new, to innovate, to bring Kaizen to the equation. And I think that's something we as a Canadian business community and Canadian engineering and STEM community need to do more of. So we've got some concept. We've got respect. We've got Kaizen or change for the good. We've got the idea of muda or waste. And then we've got the idea we can fail forward. So, but wait a second, if I'm gonna be a CEO, don't I not want to fail? You might be thinking. Well, yes, you don't wanna fail all the time. So I'm gonna give you another secret of CEO lean thinking. Crowdsource your strategy and your plans. In the day and age we have today, there's so much information out there available and you have so many talented people to draw upon and the information is readily available in a manner that's never been the case before for prior generations. You can create a good business plan or strategy by crowdsourcing it. I personally, in my company, we don't have a marketing department. I crowdsource that to another marketing company who does an amazing job on our social media pages and and all the information that we put out there about the company. I've crowdsourced that. When it comes to the strategy for my company, I don't write it. I gather as much information from my leadership team as I can because I have experts in various domains. And I put that together and we come up with a strategy. So one of the secret ingredients that every aspiring leader that ties to respect needs to have, if you're going to be a CEO in a modern age, is the ability to listen. I personally had to learn this because I am not naturally a great listener. I'm actually more of a talker. You might be surprised to hear. But I had to learn that skill over time. My wife, my sons would actually say I'm still not very good at it, but I'm getting better all the time. So I'm trying to Kaizen my ability to listen. If you listen to folks and you crowdsource that solution, any strategy is actually very easy to put together. Because quite simply, strategy is a fancy word for a plan. And if you get everybody involved in it to create this plan, and when we go about doing our company, we say we want a 10-year vision of where we want to be, and we get the whole team working on it, and then we break it down into one-year chunks at a time. You know, we're going to do these projects this year that are aligned with that 10-year vision. If I were to sum it up, I think I have the best job in the world. And it's, I would tell you the secret is it's actually pretty easy. Don't tell my boss because I don't want him to cut my pay. But it's fairly easy to do because if you just keep in mind, create a simple strategy where you've got everybody involved so they're all bought into the plan. Keep in mind the twin pillars of respect and continuous improvement. You too could run a business someday and take Canada to the next level. Thank you.